And then we came back that Sunday afternoon, and that's when we heard they had found a body up at Gracie Evans Field.
I don't know, it was in the 80s that day. It was brutal hot. And still, I didn't make the connection as to who it was because
at that point, nobody knew, you know, or they hadn't identified the body. There was a lot of buzz in town as to who was it, you know, who's missing? Which one of our friends isn't around? Who could it be?
But I remember them taking me down and I had to identify the body and the jewelry. They had the jewelry in a bag. And then you had the physical, you had to go down. We went to this really dark place. And my dad just sat there and he's like, you know, and I'm like, yeah, you know, you could tell. I mean, it wasn't pretty, but it was pretty obvious.
It was pretty scary because, of course, we were all worried that there was somebody out there, a lunatic out there, and a murderer and a crazy person.
The day after we all found out that she had been murdered, the morning after, it's the first time I ever locked my house door in my life.
Something like this doesn't happen in a little town.
I know a lot of bad things happen in the world, but this happened in our world. This happened right here in Kennebunk.
It's one of those terrible, terrible things that happen, and you just feel so badly for the family, and you're also saying, thank God it wasn't my daughter.
She was in a hurry. She had to go. She said something about going hitchhiking to Massachusetts.
I wouldn't think she'd get into a vehicle not knowing somebody. I don't know her as well as other people do, but...
But she was desperate.
She was in a hurry to get to Massachusetts. My gut tells me that whoever picked her up was the person who did it, but I don't know.
It had to have been somebody she knew. That's my own personal opinion. I'm not going to say who I thought it was or is. In my own mind, I still think that's the individual... even today, that did it.
There may be a killer among us still.
One of the saddest moments I had is when I got married, and her mom was really good friends with my mom, and she came to my wedding, and I just kept thinking about how sad it must be for her to see me get married and know that her child never will be able to, you know, never have that moment. And I almost felt kind of guilty about my happiness because I was feeling pain for her mom to see me, one of Mary's good friends, go through that and know that her daughter would never be able to do that.
She was just a kind, gentle soul. She could have been everybody's little sister.
What went through your mind when you found out who it was?
I couldn't believe that I get teary just thinking about it. Gosh, I don't know why I'm... just that somebody's so sweet. You know, she wasn't a party animal. She's just a sweet kid.
The best thing about her was she was just a loving child. She just loved everybody. And nobody disliked her, nobody.
At 18, she looked about 12 years old. I don't think anybody in the town ever got her out of the 12-year-old mode.
She was robbed of everything. Didn't even get to finish high school.
It's always been on our mind for 35 years, 36 years now, almost. And it's just unfinished. It's always been something that we've always thought about and wondered about, and who was it, who was responsible.
You know, I was able to have a good life, but I always think of Mary, and I think about what she's missed. All her opportunities that were stolen. To hug her child, to have grandchildren of her own, to live her life.
Like I said, with Facebook, wow, where else can you get 200, 300, 400 people together in an instant and discuss something?
I didn't think about it much over the years, but when that popped back up on Facebook, it all came back, you know, all the horrible feeling in your gut.
Facebook is huge. It's a great tool to have. So to have something that's just, you know, for Mary and the cause, it keeps it on, I want to say, you know, one of the front burners.
doing good. You remember me?
I do.
You look great in your face. You know it too.
There's a part of us that never grew up from 1978. We're still back there.
Because a lot of people are afraid. This is a murder that's unsolved. I've had people show up at my house and I've sat on my porch with them. One person was shaking, reliving events of the night before this happened to Mary, reliving detail, describing cars that were at the party, describing people at the party, describing the time of day.
Somebody may know something out there. You know, it's like it's a puzzle you're putting together, and we need all those pieces.
I think also a lot of people are scared. They don't want to say what they know because they don't know who did it, and so they don't want to speak. And it really makes me mad. The people that have come forth, I would say 90% are women.
Isn't that odd? Do you think that's odd?
I do think it's odd, and I don't understand why, because men are supposed to be the brave ones.
If the town heals, that's what justice for Mary is. It's to bring it, not to be forgotten, but to bring it full circle.
We'll see what happens, that's all. I just do whatever I can to keep advancing the cause, because every day I believe in it a little more.
But that was Mary, you know. Chapter end, here we go. Chapter 13, on to the next case, you know. And this is what we say, close it, but don't forget her.
She was a good, decent kid and came from a great family in a small town in America. So I think there's some justice in knowing that she wasn't forgotten.
All in the end, this person, whoever did this, will have God to deal with. And justice will be done.
Yep, they'll be judged.
At that point, if not sooner.
I don't know, I don't have the words. She's one of our crew, one of our people. I don't know what to say. You know, I don't know how to describe it, how to put it in the correct words. She was one of ours.
Whatever may solve this crime, I think it may be in the details. It may be in something little. It may be in somebody saying, I remember this exactly happening.